Chapter 3. Reception. In 1825, some 34 years after Wolfgang's death, his sister-in-law Sophie gave an account of Mozart's final days.
When Mozart fell ill, we made him a nightshirt which he could put on from the front, for he could not turn over because of the swelling. And as we did not know how very ill he was, we also made him a quilted dressing gown, so that he would be well protected when he got up. And so we visited him diligently. He made it plain that he was greatly delighted by the dressing gown. I went to visit him in the city every day, and once, when I went in on a Saturday, Mozart said to me, "Now, dear Sophie, tell Mama that I am getting on very well, and that I will be coming out to her in the octave of her name day to give her my congratulations." Whose joy could be greater than mine when I brought my mother such glad tidings, after she could scarcely expect the news? So I hurried home to calm her fears, after he had really seemed to me to be cheerful and well. The next day was a Sunday. I was still young, and, I admit it, vain. And I liked dressing up, but I never liked walking from our suburb into the town in my best clothes, and I had not the money for going by carriage. So I said to our good mother, "Dear Mama, I shan't go into Mozart today. He was so well yesterday, so he'll be better still today, and one day more or less will make no difference." She then said, "I'll tell you what, make me a cup of coffee, and then I'll tell you what you can do." She was rather concerned to keep me at home, for my sister knows how much she always wanted me to be with her. So I went into the kitchen. The fire had gone out. I had to light a taper and kindle the fire. But Mozart was still constantly on my mind. My coffee was ready, and my candle was still burning. I then saw how wasteful I had been to have burnt so much of my candle. The candle was still burning brightly, and I stared straight at my candle and thought, "I wonder how Mozart is." And as I was thinking this and looked at my candle, the candle went out. It went out as if it had never been alight. Not even a spark remained on the big wick. There was no draught, to that I can swear. I shuddered, ran to our mother and told her. She said, "All right, hurry up and take those clothes off and go in. But come and tell me straight away how he is. Now don't be long." I hurried as fast as I could. My God, how frightened I was when my sister, half demented, yet trying to control herself, came to meet me and said, "Thank God you've come, dear Sophie. He was so bad last night that I never thought he would survive this day. Stay with me today, for if he gets bad again today, he will die in the night. Go into him for a little and see how he is." I tried to control myself and went up to his bed when he called to me at once. "Ah, dear Sophie, it is good of you to come. You must stay here tonight. You must see me die." I tried to be strong and to dissuade him, but he answered to all my attempts, "I have the taste of death on my tongue already." And, "Who will look after my dearest Constance if you don't stay?" "Yes, dear Mozart, but I must first just go and tell our mother that you would like me with you tonight, or she will think some misfortune has happened." "Yes, do that, but come back soon." God, how awful I felt. My poor sister came after me and begged me for heaven's sake to go to the priests at St. Peter's and ask one of the priests to come, as if on a chance visit. That I also did, though the priests hesitated a long time, and I had great difficulty in persuading one of these inhumane priests to do it. Then I hurried to our mother, who was anxiously awaiting me. It was already dark. How frightened the poor dear was. I persuaded her to go and spend the night with her eldest daughter, Hofer, and so it was. And I ran back as fast as I could to my inconsolable sister. Süssmayr was there at Mozart's bedside, and the well-known Requiem lay on the coverlet, and Mozart was explaining to him how he thought he should finish it after his death. There was a long search for Closset, the doctor, who was found in the theatre, but he had to wait till the play was over. Then he came and prescribed cold compresses on his burning head, and these gave him such a shock that he did not regain consciousness before he passed away. The last thing he did was to try and mouth the sound of the timpani in his Requiem. I can still hear it now.
Are you still?
margin Sophie Heibel's melodramatic account of Mozart's final hours. It was, according to her, quite literally his last words. But hers was not the first account to give the Requiem such a prominent place in accounts of Mozart's death. Within a month of his passing, stories started to circulate in Austria and Germany that he had composed the Requiem under mysterious circumstances, and that he believed he was writing it for himself. A local Salzburg newspaper reported that
some months before his death, he received an unsigned letter asking him to write a Requiem and to ask for it what he wanted. Because this work did not at all appeal to him, he thought, "I will ask for so much that the patron will certainly leave me alone." A servant came the next day for his answer. Mozart wrote to the unknown patron that he could not write it for less than 60 ducats, and then not before 2 or 3 months. The servant returned immediately with 30 ducats and said he would ask again in 3 months, and if the mass were ready, he would immediately hand over the other half of the money. So Mozart had to write it, which he did, often with tears in his eyes, constantly saying, "I fear that I am writing a requiem for myself." He completed it a few days before his death. When his death became known, the servant came again with the remaining 30 ducats, but did not ask for the requiem, and since then there has been no further inquiry.
There is much that is patently false here. In her earliest account of the Requiem, Constanze claimed that Mozart was enthusiastic about the work. There is no evidence in any contemporaneous letter or document that Mozart believed he was composing the work for himself, and of course he did not complete it. Where could such an account have come from? Given the secrecy that apparently surrounded the commission, it can only have come from someone in Mozart's inner circle, perhaps someone with an agenda, either to dissuade Walsegg from claiming the work or to suggest that Mozart had indeed completed the Requiem. Whatever the reason, the anecdote successfully staked a claim on the historical narrative that was to spring up concerning Mozart's swan song. Virtually every biography of the composer written before about 1850 tells more or less exactly this story. Not every account of the Requiem describes the work in terms that became common in the late 19th and 20th centuries, that it is a work of consolation, heart-searchingly supplicatory, transcendentally leading us toward peace and salvation, a demonstration that death is not a terrible vision, but a friend. For much of the early Romantic period, it was just the opposite. An early Mozart biographer, Ignaz Arnold, described the Requiem as gloomily serious and darkly melancholic, while the composer Christian Friedrich Schwenker thought it lacked the pious humility demanded of an appeal to the mercy of the Redeemer. The Swiss writer Hans-Georg Nägeli objected to the many violent changes of key and arbitrary alternations of major and minor that turned the Kyrie fugue into what he described as a barbarous confusion of sounds. And the German writer Gottfried Weber was convinced the Confutatis was not by Mozart because, he said, it emphasizes con amore the egotistical baseness of the words and by the ferocious unison of the stringed instrument maliciously incites the judge of the world to hurl the cursed crowd of sinners into the deepest abyss. Weber's polemic was part of an ongoing debate during the 1820s concerning the authenticity of parts of the Requiem. It was not clear to writers at the time exactly how much of the work Mozart had completed. Much of the debate surrounded Süssmayr's contribution, and the apparent contradiction between early assertions that Mozart had left sketches and instructions for its completion, and Süssmayr's claim to the publisher, Breitkopf & Härtel, that the Sanctus, Benedictus and Agnus Dei were wholly composed by him. The question was, and remains, irresolvable, notwithstanding the survival of at least one Mozart sketch for an Amen fugue to follow the Lacrimosa. And yet, the real issue was not who composed what, but the work's character, or better, early views of Mozart's character. Weber's refusal to believe that Mozart wrote the Confutatis was not a reflection on Süssmayr's compositional prowess, but on his view of Mozart's character, and, as a result, the character of his music. Clearly, Weber thought the composer incapable of being egotistically base, and could not, as a result, have written such a setting of the Requiem text. Debates concerning the authenticity of parts of the Requiem subsided by mid-century, about the time that views of the work's character also changed. No longer seen as dark and foreboding, the Requiem was transformed into a work of heroic consolation. In no small part, this change was coincidental with broad changes in cultural attitudes. During the 18th century, death was seen as terrifying. In his 1743 poem, The Grave, Robert Blair wrote, "The grave, dread thing, men shiver when thou art named. Nature appalled shakes off her wonted firmness. Ah, how dark thy long-extended realms and rueful wastes, where naught but silence reigns, and night, dark night." Cemeteries, mostly located within city walls, only reinforced this image. They were unsanitary, malodorous and chaotic, a breeding ground for disease and fear. But this image began to change toward the end of the century, when graveyards were moved outside cities and turned into landscaped gardens intended to foster contemplative repose. Père Lachaise in Paris was the first such garden cemetery, and many others were constructed in subsequent decades. More important still were changing attitudes towards death itself. Whereas in the late 17th and 18th centuries fierce debates raged concerning the immortality of the soul, Thomas Hobbes, for one, argued that to believe in immortality was to forsake not only rational thought but nature itself. By the mid-19th century, there was a consensus of sorts among philosophers that the immortality of the soul resided not in religion, but in man's drive to perfection. As early as 1781, Kant had argued that human virtue is attainable only if there is infinite progress, hence there must be another life after this one, an idea that in the formulation of Johann Gottlieb Fichte became a poetic assertion of the primacy of the ego. He writes, "Even though my body may decay and become dust, this body is not I. Long after the youngest among the millions of suns which shine over my head has sent forth its last rays of light, I shall still remain, unaltered and intact, the same as I am today." The 19th century rehabilitation of death as something distinctly human, as something to be celebrated, is reflected in the performance history of the Requiem. Almost from the beginning of the 19th century, the Requiem was performed not so much as a liturgical work, but as a concert piece. It was given at Covent Garden in 1801 and by students of the Paris Conservatoire in 1804. Before long, the Requiem came to represent the celebration of death in general, of both the great and the small. In Berlin, it was given during a period of mourning for the Queen Mother. At Leipzig, it was played in honour of the Imperial French governor of the city. And a performance in Prague in 1801 to honour a local music patron made such an impression that, according to a local report, a few days later, two citizens requested that it be performed at memorial services for their relatives. More importantly, the Requiem came to symbolise the death of greatness, the death of art, and the death of the human spirit. It was a musical centrepiece at the funerals of the poet Heinrich von Collin, of Karl Maria von Weber, Beethoven, and, later, Napoleon. There, things rested until the mid-20th century, when a different kind of debate arose concerning the Requiem, albeit a throwback to the authenticity debates of the 1820s. But it was not Mozart's authorship that was called into question. Rather, it was Süssmayr's completion of the work, and whether he had, in fact, been up to the task. Certainly, this was not an entirely new debate. At various times during the 19th and early 20th centuries, the movements composed by Süssmayr had been omitted and their places taken by comparable movements from other masses by Mozart. Even the principals did not quite agree on some of the details. In the Confutatis, for example, Eibler positioned the entry of the trombones slightly differently than Süssmayr had. Nevertheless, it was only with the publication of a new critical edition that clearly differentiated Mozart's work from Süssmayr's that scholars began to examine the work more closely and to find serious fault with the completion. So serious, in fact, that several new versions of the piece were produced, some making cosmetic changes to Süssmayr's work, others making wholesale changes, even to the point of throwing out altogether virtually everything that was not authentically Mozartian. These new versions of the Requiem included completions by Franz Bayer, Duncan Drus, Richard Maunder, H.C. Robbins Landon, Robert Levin, and Simon Andrews. Since Mozart more or less completed the vocal parts and bass line for much of the piece, the revisions to sections composed by him mostly affect aspects of the music where Mozart's notation is incomplete, in particular the orchestration. How would Mozart have scored the work if he had had time to finish it? The example of the violin part at the Quam olim abrahe fugue suggests that he was sensitive not only to individual sounds and their connections across the work, but also to sonic environment more generally, to oral imagination, a point noted by Duncan Drus.
Süssmayr's completion has quite a lot to recommend it, but one looks in vain for the imaginative touches of orchestration. If we look at the introit, the one movement that Mozart totally completed, or virtually completed in all its orchestral detail, you see that though the orchestra is very much an accompaniment to the chorus and the solo voice, there are beautiful touches of orchestral colour. And I think as I got to know the Mozart Requiem before attempting my completion, it was that lack of orchestral colour that first made me critical of what Süssmayr had done.
This gives rise to any number of interpretative possibilities. The striking opening trombone solo in the Tuba Mirum was indicated by Mozart, but H.C. Robbins Landon has pointed out that it is not clear how long the trombone should continue, and allots subsequent passages, which Süssmayr gives to the trombone, to the bassoons. In the Recordare, for example, Drus has the strings fall silent at the vocal entries, accompanying them only with the winds. This is different from Zeusmeyer's original and Beyer's edition, which have the strings accompany the first entry of the voices. And that is different again from Levin, who opts for no doubling of the voices at all. The differences are subtle but audible, and weave a tapestry of accompanying sounds that, consciously heard or not, have an impact on the mood, on the effect of the work. Or they draw attention to themselves, thereby altering the relationship of voices to orchestra, text to gesture, the relationship among the various actors in the piece, as happens with Andrew's rewriting of the string texture at the Domine. For those sections written by Zeusmeyer, voice leading, that is, the conduct of the individual voices relative to each other with respect to the rules of counterpoint, is among the more obviously unsatisfactory aspects of his work. The younger composer frequently violated the rules of counterpoint, such as parallel octaves between voices, which critics have been quick both to point out and to correct. In some instances, the choice of pitch, even a single pitch, makes an audible difference, producing an entirely different dissonance, as happens in Maunder's version of the Agnus Dei, a single G-flat climactically replacing a G-natural in the Zeusmeyer. Here is Zeusmeyer, followed by Maunder. Maunder also alters the dynamic of the final phrase, removing Zeusmeyer's crescendo, keeping a piano dynamic to the end of the movement. The opening of Hostias presents another issue about dynamic level. Zeusmeyer gives no dynamic here, and while it has been traditional to adopt a piano, given the text at this point, Levin observes that in the Baroque and classical style, the absence of a marking would imply a default forte. Sweeping problem for all completions of the Requiem concerns the possibility that Mozart left sketches for it that have long since disappeared, a possibility made concrete not only by statements from Constanze Mozart, but also by the survival of a fragment of an Amen fugue written around the time of the Requiem, and in the same key that is presumed to have been intended for the Lacrimosa. Whether Zeusmeyer was aware of this fragment and rejected it, his version of the Lacrimosa does not include a fugal Amen, is not known. But what if other fragments were used by Süssmayr, scraps of material on which he may have based later movements or extended contrapuntal passages? Duncan Drus thought this might be the case for the Hosanna fugue at the end of the Sanctus and Benedictus.
It's not always entirely clear what might have been Süssmayr's starting point, that is, assuming that he had a Mozartian material to go on. And one had to think what the material to base the new movements would actually be. To take an example, the Hosanna fugues that come at the end of the Sanctus and Benedictus, I took just the fugue subject, which is melodically related to a lot of the other material in the Requiem. But if you start looking at the counterpoint when the second voice enters and the third and fourth voice enter, one can see that this isn't the kind of counterpoint that Mozart would have written. So I felt I could only take the subject of that fugue and had to set to try and write a fugue that would be more Mozartian.
When the scoring, voice leading, and other aspects of the musical text have been changed, when the presumed infelicities of the Süssmayr version are corrected, what is really at stake in these new versions of the Requiem? What is the debate really about? It is, in the end, not a technical debate, although it manifests itself in technical discussions, but an aesthetic one. It is a throwback to the 1820s, which cast into doubt the expressive authenticity of various sections of the piece. There can be no questioning now of what Mozart wrote, whether he realised his own ambitions and vision for the work, limited as they may be by the Requiem's incompleteness. We do not question Mozart, though well we might, but we can and have questioned Süssmayr, and in that way focused the debate once again on expressive authenticity, albeit in a roundabout way. The notion that an unimportant and undistinguished composer like Süssmayr could not possibly have succeeded entirely in realising an authentic Mozartian vision is really just a substitute for the bigger question that lurks behind this torso of a work. What does Mozart's Requiem really express? What is its authentic meaning? That, of course, is a question of biography, and one that cannot adequately be answered. We do not, and never will, know exactly what was in Mozart's mind when he wrote the work. Biography, in any case, is as much about the present as the past, for we are incapable of reconstructing a life except through the lens of history and the lens of reception, through an accretion of facts and hypotheses, of intended or unintentional biographical motivations. We can, accordingly, ask not only historical, aesthetic, or technical questions about the Requiem, but also biographical ones. The composer Michael Finnessy does just that in his version of the Requiem.
What I'm proposing in completing the Requiem in the way that I have done is a sort of what-if journey. What if Mozart had lived that much longer? And what if we stop thinking about Mozart as a kind of arrested child prodigy, but we think about all the other impact that Mozart's music might have had on future generations of composers, let's say coming up as far as Hindemith and Schoenberg. From the point of view of composing the Mass, I was taking into account more than one level of musical responsibility, if you like. And the Lacrimosa is in the middle of a sequence of sections which Mozart actually did complete. It was the last part of the work which he didn't complete. He wrote the first 8 bars of the Lacrimosa and then stopped. The myth is that he was so emotionally disturbed by the words that he was unable to continue. And so the end of the movement is not there. Süssmayr had to complete it from sketches or whatever materials. It's a little bit uncertain what materials Süssmayr actually might have had at his disposal, because some of them have disappeared. So as it's in the middle of the sequence, I chose to write it, bringing it very, very gently forward from Mozart's period, let's say through composers like Rossini to Bellini at the start of the 19th century. So it begins its journey by gently edging away from Mozart. Nothing controversial, nothing modernistic, nothing even referring to Beethoven or Schubert. In fact, later on I also bring my own work, continuing the Mozart Requiem, as far forward as Schoenberg in the present day.